This is a really good book. The explanations are almost exactly the way I would do it. It's almost as if they're reading my mind. I wonder who wrote this. Shander Lahoski and Richard Russick. That's me. When did I write this? 1994? That's a long time ago. I'm a lot older than I thought. I'm going to put this book down. That one right there. What other books do we have here? Let's see. Introduction to Counting and Probability by David Patrick. Not by me, but still a good book. It says back here, David Patrick, PhD in math from MIT. I don't think they give those to dummies. He must be a pretty smart guy. Let's see what we have. Look at that. Picture of a tree. Tree for choosing four books, it says. Choosing four books. Foreshadowing. Put that one right there. And then this book. Oh no, this book's too heavy. Intermediate algebra. It's a thick one. I'm going to pick a lighter one to use. I'm going to use this one instead. Intermediate counting and probability. That first counting and probability book was so good, we asked David to write a sequel. We'll put that right there. Aren't they pretty? They're just so nice. It's fun just to look at them. Then we have this little book. Little book for little kids, more specifically for parents of little kids. This one's written by Chris Wright, it says, and he's PhD in math from Stanford. I don't think Stanford's given math PhDs to dummies either. And you know how you know this is a good book? That's my sister-in-law, and that's one of my nieces. With their pictures on the cover, it has to be a great book. So we're going to put that right here. I'm just going to look at them. So nice. But this isn't the only way we could have stacked them. I could have put this one here and this one on top. Or I could have slid this one. This one's probably the oldest book. We're going to put that one on top. Lots of ways we could stack these. And well, that's what we're going to do. We're going to figure out how many different ways we could stack these books. Now, it would really help. It would help you a lot to follow along. If you had these books too, so if you had copies of all these books and you could just play along with me while we're figuring out this problem. So if you have them, go get them. And if you don't, what you should do is you should order them. So you're going to hit the pause button now, go order the books, and I'll wait for you. Okay, great. You got the books. Now we're ready to go. Now, we might at first think, well, we're trying to make a stack of four books here. So there are four places. And any book can go in any place. I can take any one of these books can be the first book, and any of the four books can be the top book. So I have four choices for the top, four choices for the bottom, and four choices for each of the middle places. So it looks like it's just four times four times four times four. But just to make sure, let's go ahead and build a tree like we did with when we were counting independent events. And so we'll start with our four books. And again, we're going to use, we got our four colors, and we're going to use one color for each book. And say, we'll start from the beginning, and we'll draw a line for each possible choice. Start with the black book, and the book for blue, book for green, and a book for red. So we have four choices at the beginning. Choose any book to be on the bottom. And over here, I'm going to go ahead and choose this book. That book will be first. And up here we'll say that we chose the black book. Now once we've chosen one book, then there are three books left. You see we've got three books left here. And up here, say, after we've chosen black to go first, I've got three colors left. I can go with red, go with the green, or I can go with the blue. And already we're starting to be suspicious about the whole 4 times 4 times 4 times 4 thing, because here we did have four choices at first, but now we only have three choices here. I'm going to go ahead and choose this book down here. And once I've chosen my first two books, I only have two choices left. And we can see that pretty clearly in our tree as well. After we go black and then red, well, all we have left are green and blue. So I can go green or I can go blue. I do have two choices here. And then with the next one, I can go with the blue or with the red. And then last, if I went black and then blue, I can go with red or green. So we see that no matter what two books we choose to go first and second, we always have two choices after that. And here I'm going to go ahead and pick this one from our two choices. And then at the end, after we've chosen the first three books, there's just one book left. One book left. Little book. I'll put that. Aren't they nice? And then up here in our tree, after we've chosen three colors, well, there's only one left. On the top here, when we go black, red, green, there's only blue left. There's only blue left down here. And let's see, in this one, there's only green left here, and only green left here, and only red left here or here. And now our tree is starting to tell the story. So at the beginning, we have four choices. And then after we've chosen our first choice, well, for the part of the tree that we filled out, we see that we have three choices for the second book. And then for each of those, we have two choices for the next book. And then no matter what we've chosen so far, there's only one book at the end. And the same thing will happen, no matter which book we choose first. So we have four choices at the beginning. And for each of these four choices, we can make a tree just like this. So we could have filled up the whole board and we'd have been here for a long time. And I'd be switching pens a lot and that would have been a pain. But for each of these four choices, we'll have a tree that looks just like this. So for each of these four choices, we'll have 3 × 2 × 1 ways to stack all the books total. That gives us 24 ways to stack up all the books. And again, our tree makes this very clear. We start from the beginning. We have four choices. And then for each of those four choices, no matter which one we choose, we'll then have three choices. And then no matter what we've chosen first and second, we'll then have two choices for each of the 4 × 3 ways we could have chosen the first two books. And finally, there's just the one book, one way to choose the last book at the end. So it's just a multiplication problem, just like it was with independent events. But these choosing books for our stack, well, these aren't independent events. These are not independent because once I choose one book, I can't choose it again. My first choice does affect my later choices. Once I've picked this one, I can't pick it again. But what's important here is the number of choices I have is independent. No matter what book I pick first, I'll have three choices for the next one. So no matter what book I pick first, I'll have three choices for the next one. No matter what book I pick second, I'm going to have two books left for the third book. No matter what book I pick third, there's only going to be one book left for the last one. So while my choices themselves are not independent, the number of choices I have at each step is, and we can still build this tree, it's still a multiplication problem. So we figured out how to count the number of ways I can stack these four really nice books here. But it turns out, we at Art of Problem Solving, we have a lot more than four books. Hoo boy, that's a lot of books. Aren't they pretty together though? I'm gonna put this on top. Yeah, they just look nice. Nice, pretty, big stack of books. Now, we certainly don't want to do this problem again for 5, and then for 6, and then for 7. All the way up to, I don't know how many y'all have there, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. We got 11 books here. This is a lot of books. So rather than do the problem over and over again for a bunch of different numbers, what we'd like to do is find a general method that'll work for any number of books. So basically you'll find a formula or a method that'll solve this problem. And in math, we call this generalizing the problem. So we've already done it for a specific case. We've done it for 4. But what we want is to come up with a method or a formula that'll work for any number of books. So what we're going to do here, I'm going to take this huge stack and kind of push it back a little bit. And we want a method that'll work for any number of books. So we're going to say, instead of saying there are 11 books here, we're going to say there are n books. So there are n books. And we want to figure out how many ways we can stack these n books here. So for our first choice, we can pick any one of these books. We can pick any book. So go ahead and pick this one. So for our first book in the stack, there are n ways to choose. Then no matter what book we've chosen first, there are n minus 1 books left. Because we've already placed one, that leaves n minus 1. And we can take any of those books and put it next. So that gives me n times n minus 1 ways to choose the first two books. Once I've chosen two books out of the n, then I have n minus 2 still in my stack, so I can take any one of those. I've got n minus 2 choices, so that gives me n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 ways to pick the first three books. And we can keep going like this, n-3, n-4, and every time we take a book off the stack, we have one less choice, n-3. And say we keep on going, just keep taking books, and then at the end, we get down to a point, we've taken all these books, and say we just have three books left at the end. So then we have three choices. Go ahead and pick this one. Two books left. So I have two choices. And then finally, whatever book is left goes on the top. We just have the one choice of the book that goes on top. And we have n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 all the way down to 1. This is the number of ways we can take all of these wonderful books and put them in this one gigantic stack. Isn't that nice? These are nice books. Now this happens so much in math. I'm going to go ahead and lower this stack so you can actually see the board. This happens so much in math, we have a special name for it. We call this a factorial. And we also have a special symbol for it. And that symbol is just an exclamation point. So when you see this in math, an exclamation point, it doesn't mean N! It means start from n and multiply all the way down to 1. So the answer to our first problem, when we just had four books, the number of ways we could stack these was just 4 factorial, which is just the way we write 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. Now if you still don't quite understand the factorials and you've rewound and watched it a couple times, and you still don't quite understand the factorials, I do have a recommendation for you. If you'd like to just read about it, maybe you like reading more than watching videos, this is the book you want right here, Introduction to Counting and Probability by David Patrick. You can read all about factorials right here.